I've been trying to write this script 3 times now because there's so much going on, not just regarding the target focus, but everything surrounding it. Trying to get to the point has become a bit of a chore because, stepping back, I realize that while I do hate what I've been trying to talk about in this video, it's not so much that it is the main problem, but a massive symptom of underlying issues. Look, I'm just going to cut to the chase. Season 2 of Helluva Boss is 2 episodes in, unless another one comes out during production of this video, and so far, it has failed to hit the same level of enjoyment as Season 1, as flawed as it already is. A big factor of why I think this is comes in the form of shifting the focus from a group of imps taking hitman commissions for those seeking revenge on people in the human world to a ship that the canon had to twist itself around to make happen, and one of my least favorite ships of all time. That may sound like hyperbole, but folks, I am not going to lie to you. I hate Stolitz with every fiber of my being, and I honestly think that by making it as big a focus as the show has, the crew have written themselves into a corner, and any move they try to make to get out of that corner is going to have to be executed with no margin for error, lest it come off as an asshole. I'm not really going to explain Helluva Boss for those in the back, since there are already a million videos out there recapping it, and it's probably popped up in your recommended tab at least once, either because you checked it out of curiosity, or your sister held you at gunpoint one Thanksgiving to marathon the entire show. Just kidding, it wasn't at gunpoint. It was actually with a nut! One thing we do need to address before we get going any further is that I am aware that the show shares a universe with Has-Been Hotel, and no, I'm not covering it here. As far as I'm concerned, the two might as well be taking place in different continuities because of how detached they are from each other, and the Vivzy Poppin' crew at Spindlehorse have no intentions on making crossovers. We clear? Good. Because I'm not repeating myself. I am also going to say that because of how much this show has been covered, I'm going to try and stick to my main target, and if you want more information and context, go check out any of these videos, links in the description. With that out of the way, what is it about Blitz and Stolitz as a ship that strikes the chord of contempt on my proverbial piano? Why do I rank this ship among my most hated ships next to Danny and Sam, Sonali and Tudok? I think I should start by discussing a problem that's a plague on the series in general, and that would be that this show is moving way too fast in comparison to its production cycle. By this, I mean that the show has caught a severe case of Cerberus syndrome way too early into its lifespan, clocking in at episode 105. If you don't know, Cerberus syndrome is a trope used to describe when a show goes from typically episodic, slice of life, and or comedy driven to a more serialized, gritty, and mature direction, as demonstrated with a lot of shows throughout the 2010s, like Adventure Time, Star vs. Forces of Evil, My Little Pony, and Steven Universe. The catch is that these shows caught a case of Cerberus syndrome much later into their lifetime, typically around the season 4 mark. With Helluva Boss, there are currently 10 episodes out at time of writing, which includes the pilot that aired in 2019 and the most recent one aired late last year. If a new episode comes out in the production of this video, I will figure out how to address it in the future, so don't even fucking bring it up, please and thank you. I will also mention that there's currently 1 episode that hasn't aired yet because it's stuck in copyright limbo. What for? I don't know, and it's not very important to this video. This also gets compounded by the production cycle of Helluva and presents a variation of what I like to call Steven Bomb Syndrome. You see, back when Steven Universe was airing, the show was plagued by hiatuses that would last months on end. Any new episodes that came out once they were finished were dropped onto Cartoon Network in week-long events called Steven Bombs. Most of these episodes were filler, and it becomes extremely obvious if you binge-watched the entire series after the show finished its run. Filler that exemplified that the show's story was moving at a snail's pace. Spindlehorse puts out a new Helluva Boss episode every 2 or 3 months, depending on the complexity of animation, and sometimes affected by if an episode is closer to an 11 to 15 minute format or a 22 minute format, which artificially makes the show look like it's progressing at a natural pace, but if you binge watch it, oh my god, this is way too damn fast. And because the pacing is too fast compared to the production cycle, stuff will feel like it comes right the fuck out of nowhere. Like 105 introducing an assassination subplot, or Luna suddenly resetting to her pilot portrayal, or, oh, Damn, there it is. Because of the show's existing flaws and how the production schedule compounds it, Stolitz not only being made an official thing and major plot thread, and also having the show shifting all or most of its focus to it, especially comes out of nowhere, and it feels really artificial. I cannot, for the life of me, understand why people want Blitz and Stolitz to have a relationship. Scratch that. I cannot, for the life of me, understand why people want Blitz and Stolitz to have a genuine relationship. Remember when I said that the canon literally twisted itself to make this happen? That's not hyperbole. Up to the second half of season one, it's been established that what's going on is transactional ass jockey. Blitz and his crew can only run their business the way they can if they can access the human world, and that access comes from a little tome called the Grimoire, which belongs to the Goetia royal family. Not sure how that works if in Hasbin Hotel it's established that absolute sunshine baby Charlie is the crown princess of hell, but okay. And Stolitz will only let Blitz use it under the condition that he be Blitz's sugar daddy. Don't believe me? Pilot episode. Stolitz calls up Blitz, telling him he wants the D and all the lewd shit for Blitz to do to him.
Oh, shit! Sorry, I fucked your husband.
First official episode, 101. Stolitz calls Blitz while the gang is in the middle of a mission, trying to not fucking die, and tells him that he needs the D monthly in order to keep letting Blitz run his business, and of course rattling off all the lewd shit he wants Blitz to do to him. 102. Stolitz explicitly and very specifically hires Blitz and his crew as bodyguards on a trip intended for his daughter Octavia to take her mind off of family drama, but ends up being an excuse to flirt with Blitz and tell him he wants the D.
I'm calling the only man who can f*** me.
What?
Who can protect me? Pause.
105. The episode opens up with the aftermath of transactional ass jockeying to establish that Stolitz bumped up the schedule because of the Harvest Moon Festival, invites Blitz to the festival, and does nothing to hide flirting with Blitz at the festival. But then come 106 and 107, the entire show disregards this to paint these two wanting a real romantic relationship.
What?
Genuine question, Cho. Where the hell did this come from? Where throughout season one did any of this come from? You want us to care about this becoming a real relationship after a good chunk of the season fully establishing its transactional, whorish bartering, and that's the extent of it? I suppose I should talk about 106 a little bit, because this is where it set the stage, or at least talk about one sequence in particular. In 106, Blitz and one of his employees, Moxie, aka best character, got captured by a paranormal investigation agency, and to have information wrung out of them, they get exposed to a truth serum aerosol while in containment, where a shared hallucination sequence ensues. Besides giving a stunning animation in Moxie's POV that Disney revived itself with in the 90s, and you know damn well that modern Disney will never do because they think animation is for stupid babies! Sorry, I had some pent-up hate and frustration there. And effects and staging in Blitz's POV that actually reminds me of The Wall in some respects. This sequence simultaneously confronts Blitz about his self-destructive behavior and lets us see what's going on behind the scenes. For further context, Blitz and Moxie tend to bounce off each other pretty well because they're dynamic, further accentuated by their respective hallucinations. Where Blitz is a crass, unprofessional, at times incompetent, and a seemingly uncaring person, Moxie is formal, wimpy, more specialized in weaponry, and is much more open and wears his heart on his sleeve. Moxie's POV is straightforward and polished, while there's a lot more going on in Blitz's POV with a lot of baggage from the past. Until new episodes address it, all we have to go on is that Blitz was burned by love on several fronts, physically and emotionally, as personified by previously introduced characters. Fizzaroli is why Blitz would rather work alone. Verosica is one of probably many reasons Blitz struggles with romance, and Stryker is there to egg him into not trusting the future, or what could be. Moxie in this POV even asks the million-dollar question of if Blitz is scared of his employees leaving him like everyone else. So yeah, Blitz's usual demeanor is a front to keep himself distant and push people away so he doesn't get burned again. And yep, you can tell the guy actually cares deep down if his heart-to-heart with Moxie after the hallucination is any indication and craves affection. Fuck's sake, Blitz regularly invades Moxie's personal space and privacy to spy on him and his wife Millie, and he really wants what these two have going on.
Are you fucking filming us right now?
And where Blitz isn't afraid to show his affection is with his receptionist and adoptive daughter Luna, perhaps going overboard at points. But then you have Stolitz set atop a throne in that hallucination to be read as Blitz's ideal love, and while the arrangement could work as an interesting conflict, they try to push it as genuine. For the most part, I don't have too much of a problem with Blitz's end, and want to see him evolve as a character and through thick and thin actually be, well, a hell of a boss.
He said it!
Where most of my problems lie are with Stolitz. I already went on about him basically being Blitz's sugar daddy, and that's the main reason why I think this ship should not be legitimized. But where it makes things harder to care about this contrived couple is that Stolitz gives me a really bad itch from a writing standpoint. Most of the time, this character barely cracks being two-dimensional or being summed up as anything more than noble who doesn't understand the gravity of his royal responsibilities and is hungry for circus imp cock. I mean, they try to give us something intriguing, like his relationship with his daughter Octavia in 102 to show he's trying to act in her best interest, but
with the context of what happens before in the same story, the latter interaction comes off less like a father in disrepair trying to explain to his kid why he still loves her despite how things may appear, and more like Bojack Horseman doing another shitty, selfish thing and claiming he didn't mean to hurt anyone. The difference being that Bojack goes out of its way to say, no, you were a selfish piece of shit that wasn't thinking of anyone but yourself. It doesn't matter what kind of excuses you give, whereas in Helluva Boss, Stolitz and Via's conversation barely mentions that he almost completely ignored her by bringing Blitz along, and nonchalantly moves on to the next subject. That shouldn't be dropped so easily when it's such a majorly shitty thing to do.
Yeah, that. And with the show moving as fast as it is, it really does feel like some crucial episodes got left on the cutting room floor, and this front is where a lot of tell-don't-show goes on. I'll save stuff specifically revolving around Octavia for later, so for now, why Stolitz is a hollow character. Stolitz's side of the ship is where a lot of ass pulls to justify it as a legitimate romance started rearing its head in 106. I already mentioned the hallucination sequence and how Blitz sees Stolitz as his ideal lover, but the end of the episode is basically where the show goes, yeah, sure, let's have it be reciprocal. No rhyme or reason, no previous episodes hinting at it at all, just a deus ex machina resolution, and now Stolitz has a crush on Blitz that's not limited to bumping uglies. 107 starts to exacerbate this, where Blitz calls him up to go on a date as a cover for spying on Moxie and Millie's anniversary dinner date at a major club. After taking the fall for Moxie because horny motherfuckers can't comprehend that Eminem as a couple works beyond a primal instinct to just rail each other until their junk hurts, Blitz and Stolitz get out of there and they try to portray this as some heart-wrenching moment, when not once has the show expanded on hinting at any genuine romance. The relationship is transactional. The show established it as such, and I kinda gotta agree with Blitz here.
Stolitz, don't act like what we have is anything but you wanting me to fuck you, okay? You make that really clear all the time.
I have to keep on asking this because the show does not want to answer it and has written itself into a corner trying to justify it. What the fuck do these two see in each other that makes them want to be in a relationship that's more than just transactional ass jockeying? And no, headcanons absolutely do not fucking count. I want actual answers, and I want actual answers in the show itself. Not supplemental material like podcasts and behind the scenes vlogs, because you should not have to go out of your way to look at additional material that's not part of the story to get the full picture. And what do you know? Because 108 is stuck in copyright limbo, in comes 201 to try and answer that. In the stupidest way possible. Now, I will give 201 credit in some capacity because I found Blitz's past to be interesting, and we do get a little bit about him and Fizzaroli before things went to shit. Stolitz's segments, though. Besides another elephant in the room I'll talk about here in a bit, Stolitz on his own is a character I already struggle to empathize with, or at least take seriously. There's a lot I already ranted about and have yet to rant about, so bear with me. Where my disdain sets in is how 201 tried to flesh him out. And by flesh him out, I mean not actually flesh him out in any meaningful way, and instead do the one thing I hate in any piece of fiction, whether fan-made or not, and I'm not talking about the 50 Shades of Grey DeviantArt level smut my sister would absolutely write. No, it's the fact that the episode artificially props Stolitz up to make you feel sorry for him, and as such makes any faults he has completely disappear compared to the antagonist in his side of the story. I am not kidding you! They really tried their damnedest to reveal how much of an woo soft boy and how hard done by he is, and it's laughable! Look, it's unfortunate that his dad is basically Jafar, and that translates to a cold upbringing. It's unfortunate that Stolitz grew up with no friends, and that translates to loneliness and stunted social skills. And it's unfortunate being in a loveless arranged marriage with someone so obsessed with keeping up appearances. I'll get to Stella when I get to her, but it all reads as angsty fanfiction trying to present itself as a fairy tale complete with a love at first sight routine. Plus, while Stolitz is mistaking Blitz coming on to him while trying to get the grimoire before banging him out of pity, doesn't this count as sexual assault? Or is Stolitz really that much of a bottom bitch that he craves being in a semi-uke relationship? Oh, and Stolitz needing to take antidepressants every morning because of how much misery he's in. If the writing were better, I'd let it slide, but they were trying way too fucking hard with this episode and trying to justify why Blitz needs to come in and sweep Stolitz off his feet. What the fuck are you, a Disney princess? Newsflash! You ain't Jasmine, you ain't Cinderella, and you sure as fuck ain't Rapunzel! If you'll pardon what'll surely become habitual
it's
referencing
me.
Gorillas, Murdoch and Tootie are the rough upbringing and ooh soft boy aspects done respectively better. Look, I won't sugarcoat things. Murdoch is an asshole. He regularly abuses 2D, his plants regularly catch his bandmates in the crossfire when they go wrong. Noodle almost died during the El Manana shoot because Murdoch was using it as a front to get a rival off his back, and Russell, the absolute trooper he is, ended up getting captured by North Korea under the assumption he was some kind of sea god because he went out of his way to swim through polluted oceans to get to Plastic Beach and give Murdoch a piece of his mind. It was revealed in Rise of the Ogre that Murdoch couldn't have been dealt a worse hand to fight against. Raised by an abusive alcoholic father with no mother to be found, it's likely his mother had him at a preposterously young age, and last anyone knew, she was committed to a mental institution. Was regularly forced by Sebastian to perform in humiliating theatrical contests for drinking money and got beat up by his older brother Hannibal. Dude even got violated at the age of 9 by a lunch lady. Explains a lot, but doesn't excuse a lot of the shit Murdoch put his band through. Karma would make the rounds in Phase 5 and occasionally show up through Song Machine, but there's enough showcasing over 20 plus years of lore that Murdoch really does care about his band and worries about what they think of it. He's just really, really fucking weird about it. And I don't really know how the Cracker Island or Last Cult saga is going to play out at time of writing, but at least Murdoch is an entertaining jackass to watch.
Is editing Magma and her co-host Tenderheart, aka Best Black Kitty Ever, and Kiara just came in here. While I actually began the main video editing of this video, Gorillaz not only dropped an official trailer for Silent Running, but it's set to be released on the 8th of February. I do not have the confidence that I will get this video out before then, so I'm instead going to say, while I'm still keeping this part in the video for your behind-the-scenes look, I might as well say instead that even for everything that he's put the band through, especially if you know the band's history, Murdoch being a father figure to Noodle is a much better show of parenting than Stolitz to Via in any point. That just thought I'd throw that out there. Plus Murdoch being a better sex pest in general.
Now 2D, I adore this man. He's an airheaded pretty boy down to his last few brain cells, but he seems sweet enough. What the fandom either forgets or willfully ignores is that he's not exactly what I'd call an innocent angel, even after I just said he's basically the uwu soft boy of the group, and there's plenty of evidence of him having unsavory habits. He truly doesn't mean any harm or ill will, but it doesn't erase the fact that his stupidity causes problems and can go as far as putting someone in danger. He's been addicted to painkillers since he was a kid, and the cocktail of other drugs he's partaken in since the band started really doesn't do him any favors. He's got a dozen or so illegitimate children across the globe, and we know they're his because every single one of them has natural azure blue hair, and as Plastic Beach has shown, Stort Pot off his meds and on the verge of snapping from being pushed around is a time bomb waiting to go off. I know Gorilla's lore has taken a hit since Cass Brown left and Damon and Jamie have to try and manage this themselves, but it's kept more consistent than what's going on with Stolitz. If Helluva wasn't trying to convert to a serious, serialized drama and stayed an episodic comedy, I wouldn't have that much of a problem since you wouldn't be expected to take Stolitz's situation seriously. So now we have one party that's well fleshed out with relatable flaws and another party that can barely be considered two-dimensional, propped up by angsty fanfiction tropes, trying to have a genuine relationship together that cannot work given what the pilot, season 1, and season 2 premiere has given us, because the conflict may have been interesting, but the chemistry is non-existent and the feelings are shallow. In order to make this work, the staff has resorted to yet another fanfiction trope I really don't like and brings the maturity of the story into serious question. Buckle up, it's gonna get gnarly. I've held off on talking about Stella for this long because I have a lot of problems with how she and her marriage to Stolitz have been handled, and it's going to be a really touchy subject for me. From her very first appearance, Stella isn't exactly a saint or wife of the year material. She's abrasive, she's shallow, she's quick to anger and more concerned with maintaining appearance above all else. She's more mad at the fact that Stolitz fucked a lower class being than the fact he cheated on her to begin with and actually ordered a hit on her husband from an assassin right in front of him and their daughter. Most of this has been steeped in ambiguity, and we don't know the full extent of why Stella's a bitch. In fact, I actually dig the idea of having Stella be a supporting antagonist if the crew played their cards right. Would I want her to be a sympathetic villain? Absolutely not. That would be a bad idea, and for some other examples of my favorite villains of all time, it would be stupid to make them sympathetic. Sometimes Thrax being hellbent on killing people as fast as he can for his own chapter in the medical books and being slick and calculating until he has to resort to brute force, or the fairy godmother trying to obtain the crown and throne for Charming while forcing Shrek and Fiona apart works just fine. Plus, one of Helluva's best attributes is having characters that have more going on to them when you peel away their more simple front. So let me ask a very serious question. Why doesn't Stella get this treatment? Why is she revealed to be a paper flat mega bitch that abuses Stolitz because she gets off to it and because she's been a mega bitch since she started her save file in this game called Life? I mean, I know why, to artificially prop up Stolitz as a healthy relationship, but it feels so goddamn disingenuous, and like the people writing it have no idea how abusive relationships actually work. What especially gets me is 201 and 202 plays it seriously when every other time the sinking shipwreck of a marriage has been shown, it's almost always been played for laughs, so how the hell am I supposed to take this? Pick one or the other. Just making Stella a one-note supervillain to artificially prop up Stolitz as a better relationship is so unadulteratedly lazy, it infuriates me. And I just know that some dummy is typing away in the comments about how Stella isn't mom of the year either and Stolitz is the better parent actually trying to provide an ideal environment for Octavia. I can't even begin to verify if this is the case or not because we've never been shown mom and daughter interacting at any point during the show thus far. We get told that Via and Stella were out doing something in 107, and I don't even count the start of 102 as any kind of mark on Stella's parenting or the kind of wife she is, because for all we know, she could have already checked on a nightmare earlier and needed to be up early for royal shit or something and being a blanket hog. Look, I'm a woman myself. We're all blanket hogs. This means nothing. And because people rely on headcanon to fill in the gaps if it's not answered in the show or in bonus material that you shouldn't have to look at in order to get satisfying answers, this has made way for one of the most unhealthy coping mechanisms for an audience I've witnessed. Look, I'm just now in the process of repairing my relationship with my own mom after circumstances last year I don't want to talk about finally came to a head and made her realize she is a major cause or contributor to my mental health issues. Octavia is a character I find relatable, what with dealing with her own emotional and parental issues, and I sympathize with her a lot. But until we get more about Stella and Via's relationship, any defenses or whatever crap making Stolitz the infinitely better parent is going to win my ire. Especially considering 102 exists where, if you were paying attention, Stolitz spends most of the time flirting with the guy that's causing friction in his marriage on a trip meant to take his daughter's mind off said friction. I would like even a crumb of actual screen time in show don't tell format of what Octavia's relationship with her mom is like, but the way the show is going so far, I just know that I'm going to get something that would definitely come right out of the malicious compliance subreddit. We won't get something nuanced or like Stella is somewhat well-meaning, but most of her parenting style is more in line of making sure Via keeps up appearance because of her status and she has a reputation to keep.
Professionals have standards.
But Gothel and Rapunzel's dynamic from Tangled, but done absolutely worse and tone-deaf. And it really disgusts me that there are people out there with parental issues that use this one-dimensional bitch face as a vessel to project them onto. I don't know everyone's situation regarding parents that are in the middle of divorcing or have been divorced by years, obviously. But this show is abysmal at handling doomed relationships where the couple never gets along on a heavily consistent basis. But you're being disrespectful to everyone out there who's been subject to parental alienation! Well, if we're going to play that game, in that case, hello! I am a victim of parental alienation and anxiety-induced isolation. The way this show handles this issue is fucking immature, and trying to defend it as a true-to-life portrayal is ignorant and disrespectful as hell! Fuck, I'm going to have to do an entire follow-up video just to talk about Stella and Octavia by themselves because this tangent is going on long enough and I only scratched the surface with how poorly the former is written! 202 Seeing Stars is the culmination of everything going wrong because of putting Stolitz at the forefront of a show that can't afford to waste time because it has fundamental flaws that desperately need fixed. In previous drafts, I tried to say something about how the show is in trouble at this point, and yep, this is the episode that made me finally realize that this show is in trouble. There's only one scene I liked, and it's Via and Luna talking at the observatory, and in a vacuum or in the context of 103 and a better version of 102, these two talking about their dads and them genuinely trying their best for their girls is actually really nice. It makes sense for them thematically. Everything else is a goddamn mess. The plot is a blatant copy of 102, but not nearly as competent. Eminem are my favorite couple, and I love any screen time where they're being an adorable or badass husband and wife team, but they're completely pointless to this episode. You could take them out of the episode and lose nothing. Luna had her personality completely reset to her pilot portrayal completely out of nowhere and got a heaping helping of unadulterated bitchery and unearned license to beat Blitz around. Seriously, what the fuck did you guys do to Luna this episode? If you want an abusive goth GF, go back to Sam Manson from Danny Phantom! And then there's the main attraction of the episode where it goes on to take pot shots at Hollywood and celebrity productions while Stolitz is still thirsty for Blitz instead of, oh, I don't know. looking for Octavia like you guys were commissioned to do. And as a lot of people have pointed out, this episode is trying to hard reset itself to try and get rid of the problems caused by format switch halfway through season one, and it just doesn't work. Yeah, that's another thing deserving of its own video review, because it screwed the pooch so bad. I don't know how to describe what Helluva has become other than sloppy, and that's a fucking shame considering the level of ambition and technical competency on display. Look, I really want Helluva Boss to succeed. It has a simple and creative concept that the crew can definitely get a lot of mileage out of. Most of the characters are fun to watch play off each other, the designs are great, and even the songs are pretty fun, and this show really does feel like it was made to fill the void that Panty and Stocking left for the longest time, before the news last July that the Bitchy Angels were making their glorious return.
I did my waiting! 12 years of it! In Azkaban!
I can't stop Stolitz from becoming a thing because, well, there's a fuck ton of merch of it on Shark Robot, and Vivzy has all the control by virtue of being the creator, but I don't think it's too late for the show to pull itself together and fly right. Because at the end of the day, while I enjoy seeing the character dynamics, I came to this show for hitmen from hell kicking ass and taking names. Not another yaoi series for Fujoshis with parental issues to jack off to.